This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Welcome to Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Saturday, broadcasting from Nassau, Bahamas, and streaming live on GuardianTalkRadio.com, the country's news talk radio station with fresh news and smart talk all day. Our Saturday lineup begins with The Eye Opener with Don Sargent and Tate Adderley live at 9 a.m. That's followed by Influencers with Lady Shima at 11 a.m. Next comes Candid with Anise Bell and Janae Forbes at noon. And then University Drive from the University of the Bahamas at 1 p.m. That's all straight ahead, beginning with The Eye Opener next here on Guardian Radio 96.9 Saturday.
And welcome back to The Eye Opener, your weekly dose of something absolutely positively different. I'm your host, Don Sargent. Joining me in studio this morning is...
Tate Adderley.
Tate, come on.
Sounds
Tate,
like my mic is always low.
Tate is always do this Freeport thing.
I'm just not a very enthusiastic person at all times.
But you should do public policy.
Yeah, true.
And also our guest host is with us this morning.
Stefana Nichols.
See, Brooklyn and Brown, bam, bam, ba down. Big things happen, but I'm like tired. Like, you ever like wake up?
It's been a somber week.
I feel like I'm getting old. I am getting old. Mm-hmm. My birthday was it 2 days ago?
Yeah.
I felt it. You know, when you wake up in the morning, it was like, wow, one day I was this age and the next day I'm old now. And it's like your back hurting and your knees ain't waking.
You could feel when the rain come in.
Oh, I always could feel the rain come in. That's my sixth sense. And my knees start feeling a little weird. It's like, yeah, it can rain today.
And then it
rains. Mm-hmm. So now I feel like I just need to go on the beach now.
And soak in the water?
Yes. And I've finally achieved full Bahamianness. Mm-hmm. Anyway, that's a whole other conversation. This has been a week to remember, I think. We're going to talk about that afterwards. This whole thing about, you got to talk a little bit about, come on, Kanye. Like, what's...
Something is wrong with Kanye.
I wouldn't say something. What is it?
I don't. Okay, maybe something is wrong with Kanye, but probably he's like taking on the character or something.
Yeah, I think that's what it is. I don't think it's working out.
It's not working out for him.
No.
The
no.
character is Kanye. What do you mean?
But this is now new.
This is Ye. Okay, first we're talking extreme. About Kanye, but
see,
now
I like this energy. Stick a pin right in there. We're gonna come right. I like that energy because that actually ties into a bigger thing about performances. Isn't most of what we do a performance?
Gender's performance, right?
You always got to go deep. This fellow's always got to go deep and
we
say
always
things.
On a show.
Well, that is partially true.
Yeah,
but you know, who is putting on a good show for the people, right? Good friend of the show. Can I call her? What is beyond a friend of the show? What is that? I don't know. You got to figure out another word. I got to go to get a thesaurus. A thesaurus. That could be how many of these like tongue twisters, right? Anyway, good friend of the show. We also spoke about her last week, and she's coming in a bit to talk about because, again, we like to support people who support the show. And also, you know, The Eye Opener has a long history of supporting artists. So that's part of the reason why we're trying to do this today. Tennille Burrows, otherwise known as Tada, is in the studio with us this morning. Good morning. Good morning. I call you Tennille or Tada today?
You could call me whatever you like.
Good morning, Tennille. How are you?
I'm excellent. Happy to be in the company of such enlightened young people.
Enlightened young people, are we? Sometimes I don't know. I feel it's going to be great, though. It's going to be great. Now, I know you are. You're throwing on a concert in the Atlantis. You know, I say like the tourists. I'm staying in the Atlantis.
It's in the Atlantis Theater, right?
Yes, Atlantis Theater. It's happening next Saturday, and tickets are available on Eventbrite. It's going to be the first time I'm hosting a concert in the Bahamas for 12 years.
Wow.
It doesn't feel like it was 12 years.
Yeah, 12 years.
I think I remember when you, I can't even say when you came up, but I remember when you were in, when you had come back to the country, at least if my recollection is correct, and you were Tada. That's because I never knew your name was actually Tennille. And people would be like, hey, have you seen Tennille? I was like, I don't know who this woman is. I know who Tada is. Anyway, I think I was in high school at the time, and you had performed or something at QC. And I was like, oh, this is Tada. And then every time I saw her at places, people would hug you and be like, hey, Tennille. And I'd be like, I don't know who this person is you're speaking about.
That happens.
But that's been 12 years.
It's probably been longer than that if you're talking about QC. Oh, but, Lord. Yeah, I've been. What happened was I realized a short while ago that this year marks the 25th anniversary of my recording artist career because I started when I was 17. So I was like, okay, Diamond Jubilee or whatever they call it, let me do something because I have not been, I've refused performances for the past decade or so and focused on work with advocacy, primarily around child protection. So switching gears a little bit, getting back in the habit and just doing my thing.
Is that really what just inspired this? Is just simply you haven't done it in a while, it's just like now is the time to do it? Or I'm sure there's something that happened, like with content that you've created for the music that you're going to be performing.
Well, I work closely now with Christopher Duncanson, who's a Bahamian American recording artist, songwriter, producer. And we did a song that actually was made possible by Atlantis as well as the Charitable Arts Foundation. It's called We Won't Rest. You can request it at local radio stations. Also look it up on Rise Bahamas Facebook page or YouTube. So I guess working with Christopher and featuring on the song with him, it was an opportunity to merge both of my passions in a way that, and collaborate as well with a younger person in a way that I think is meaningful. So on the song, you get the advocacy message, but then you get the Tada music vibe. So that's that was also a part of the inspiration for me to come back and do something in the Bahamas.
I want to ask a very controversial question that everybody asks. What is Bahamian music?
Oh, I have
you?
The answer. I've had the answer for quite a while.
Oh, I want to hear this.
You'd ask me that. Bahamian music is two things. First of all, Bahamian music is indigenous cultural rake and scrape, junkanoo, gombe sounds that are indicative of Bahamian origins. That's one type of Bahamian music. And the next type of Bahamian music is any type of music that is produced, recorded, written, etc. by someone that is a Bahamian. You're welcome.
Why you gotta make it sound?
It's a mic drop right there.
I think that's simple.
Because people usually say, like, if you do anything that sounds like soca, I'm Bahamian music. Or if you do anything that sounds like reggae, I'm Bahamian music.
But that's a different genre. That don't mean it's not Bahamian music.
Yes, but I think we defined Bahamian music as a genre. No, you don't think so? Like, we don't actually call rake and... Well, we do. We obviously call rake and scrape. But I think we've actually gotten to a place where people consider rake and scrape and Bahamian music to be the exact same thing, and that, therefore, Bahamian music has become a genre, which, in fact, it is not.
While y'all trying to figure it out, let's get the creative industry artisans and
absolutely
together and let and help the government figure out how we could actually create an industry in the Bahamas that's viable and thriving. As opposed to this fledgling thing where we see artists that have been performing for decades dying broke,
yeah,
such as
happening.
Tony Seymour, such as the Ronnie Butlers. I don't want to see that continue to happen. So we need to get serious as creatives, come together, and put pressure on the powers that be to actually create a sustainable industry. And if they need to look for somewhere for inspiration, look at Jamaica, look at Trinidad. Like, they actually have developed industries for entertainers and musicians that we, for some reason, have, like, mis- the boat on.
But wasn't there like a time in Bahamian history where that wasn't the case?
Yes,
it was. And then it just died?
So Ronnie Butler told me in the 70s or thereabouts, mm-hmm. there were clubs that were actually mm-hmm. owned by Bahamian mm-hmm. artists and creatives. They would do their performances there. Tourists would come. And then apparently the major hotel stream started to come on and like yuck up all the talent, put them in the hotel. So now the tourists were less motivated to go into the town, local clubs. They just
Stay in the hotel.
Stay in the hotel. And that was apparently the demise of the Bahamian club industry, native club industry, which was thriving up until that point. So I think from there. And then also changes in the industry happened. You had the advent of DJs and things like that. So that across the world caused live performances to be in less demand because, you could hire a DJ and that takes the place of Ronnie Butler or Sweet Emily singing at your event.
You know, recently, a few weeks back, the Ministry of Youth, Sports and Culture hosted, it probably was in partnership with the Ministry of Youth, Sports and Culture, maybe the Cultural Commission also. They hosted a cultural award ceremony. So to honor John Berkeley Peanuts Taylor, which is a famous drum beat, and he had a drum beat club. So during that, the Prime Minister Davis, he made a speech about bringing back those days when there were all of these clubs thriving with Bahamian artists, Bahamian musicians, performers there, and, trying to bring their focus back to the orange economy, which, they say is their focus. But, a lot of critics are saying that, you don't really see it. What is their focus? Their focus is still tourism, the orange economy. And they're, just like how you guys said, they're trying to put entertainers by the cruise port, the new cruise port. They're trying to put entertainers in the hotels, but not necessary for Bahamians to love and enjoy the music for themselves. Even with the revival of downtown.
I can't even explain how problematic that is. But you know, your stuff isn't specifically for tourist consumption. I'm presuming you want Bahamians to be there, which seems to, I wouldn't even say it seems to be irregular these days. I can't say that because I've been out to several clubs and I've noticed that Bahamian bands do play places. Mm-hmm. And I have taken special attention to like take note of that, not just see it and just go with my business, but like actually pay attention and notice it. Can we expect to, Neil, probably, I don't know if I should put you on the spot, actually, but can we expect to see you playing at different venues after this concert?
No.
Oh, okay.
No, this is one time.
Tanil has this, like, piercing look in her eyes.
Like, that was complete. That was clear. Like, no.
So if we want to catch you, better catch you at this concert.
Yes.
Is there a reason as to why?
I've refused to perform in the Bahamas for a few reasons because my focus change was one. That was the primary thing. So mm-hmm. I just prioritize my advocacy work above my artist work. Mm. But the second thing is Bahamians don't even make peanuts. They make crumbs when they perform or go around the place.
Really?
Oh, snaps.
Yeah, it's not. Yes. You're not. Agreed. I know you must be a dancer based on your logo on your shirt. So you've got dancers, singers, producers. You've got fashion icons, and you have people who have exceptional talent in many different orange economies, which is what we call the creative industries in the Bahamas, but I don't know how many of them actually can work a 9-to-5 or work full-time in their craft. Maybe 5% of the entire entertainment industry in the Bahamas can say that they can do that. So until we get to the place where we build a foundation and develop this industry to take it to the extent that it could possibly go, first of all, I think it impacts crime in a way because mm-hmm. this might seem outlandish, but I know some gangsters that got some skills.
Oh, yes.
They could rap, they could chat, they could sing, they could write.
They
I
could
literally.
Dance, I bet you and that. I know
they're
that.
They're getting views on YouTube. Like, yeah. I've seen the videos, like hundreds of thousands of views. And I was like, the videos are interesting. And I think that some certain people look at them on a certain light. But I think you have to look past like the face of it and see that these people have talents.
So
that's an industry there.
When I ran as an independent in the Elizabeth constituency 5 years ago for the 2017 general election, making my rounds, I actually happened upon someone and he was like, "Hey, you don't know me. I've been in the papers. I'm this kind of like, I've been in jail and blah, 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 blah." And I was like, "Actually, I do remember hearing stories about your case." And I was like, what's going on now? You straighten up and flying right or what? And he was like, yeah. But what I'm really trying to do is get into my rap thing, I was like, what a sick. I wish I could help him. But I couldn't. All I did was like, hey, good luck, buddy. But the thing is, when I went to music business school in Canada, I had already been a recording artist, but the main thing it caused me to do over there was network and immerse myself in a different industry and see how it worked over there. From that, I was actually able to get about $90,000 worth of funding to do two music videos from Much Music Canada. Those videos aired for millions of people in Canada and on MTV Tempo through the Caribbean. So a couple of years after that, I came back home and I was like, okay, what's going on in the music industry? So the then Minister of Youth, Sports and Culture, Neville Wisdom,
yes.
He was hosting a forum at the National Performing Arts Center on Shirley Street, the old Shirley Street Theater. So I was like, all right, this could be good. I could hear what's going on and get up to speed. So I go there, they talking this, they talking that. I was like, when are they going to get to the point of what resources are available for mm-hmm. the creative. So I stood up. I was like, hey, what's up? Yeah. So how much money y'all got to give grants to creatives? And they were like, oh, we have $30,000.
Oh, for everybody.
For everybody.
I thought you were going to say for you or for a handful of people, the whole country.
$30,000. I just come from a foreign country, collaborated with some of the artists. Got almost $100,000 worth of. I came from obscurity. They didn't know about No Tada, nothing. They just listened to the songs, liked them, realized that they were Canadian content as well, and they gave me the opportunity to do big things. It caused me to come back to the Bahamas, and people to feel like, oh, she must have made it big. But in Canada, they have something where, at that time, 33% of all music on the radio, 33% of all films aired in Canada had to be Native Canadian okay. content. And I think other countries like Ireland also implement something similar.
South Korea did the same thing.
And then you get backing not just from the government, but from the broadcasters as well. Other private corporations put into this kitty, and then you have different grant processes that people apply for. And once it constitutes Canadian content, it's applicable. And now they have more than 33% Canadian content playing on their airwaves and television networks and things like that. So there are innovative ways to approach developing a Bahamian music industry, but you have to have serious people who are in the industry that are going to band together, come forward and present what their demands are, and then the government has to be amenable to actually doing something instead of just talking.
Let me ask you this. You know, there's a union, the BMEU, Bahamas Musicians and Entertainers Union.
Trash.
What about...
Oh, sorry, I can't laugh too loud. I appreciate so that.
I don't know anything about this.
There's about to be a new union headed by Lynx Scavella. So I would say be on the lookout for that. And it's for all entertainers, I believe, not just musicians. But I think I took a look through the Constitution and it... You know, it makes sense what they're trying to do, but we need unions, we need associations. We have a few. I know we have a film association. I know we have a performing arts association in Grand Bahama, theater is more vibrant.
Yeah.
But we need like stuff for musicians, and particularly those in the industry that I'm a part of.
There's a recently started Bahamas Dance Association, started by Shanae Comer and Tiara Josie. There's also a new union, artist union, headed by President, I think is Anita. Her last name escapes me, but she is the female steel pan player.
Oh, okay.
Yes, that's a new musician. Anita, I think about Ellis? Two. Yes, mm-hmm. I think it's about 2 years old now.
So we need to gather up all these associations and unions or whatever, get them to have a meeting.
Yeah.
And go from there. Mm-hmm.
It's not about the trade union congress. That union congress, the compilation.
I wouldn't mess with them. I don't like them people. But that's another story.
I'm just saying, but isn't that kind of what it was supposed to be for?
Y'all just give me hope, you know. Y'all just give me hope that there's a chance. I'm a very cynical person. If you haven't noticed, if you're listening to the show and you don't know that, I'm an extraordinarily cynical person. But it's clear that it's not like we have a lack of ideas, right? Which is beautiful. Because when you have a lack of ideas, it's usually when... you're basically dead.
Mm-hmm.
But we're not in that type of situation now, which is great. I hope by us doing this helps to elevate these sorts of ideas and voices. I want to assume that this administration seems to be listening more often than not, but not as much as they should.
Well,
but
you know, the only cultural ground that I remember seeing was a cultural ground.
You spend more than on gas, so $30,000.
BDB. Well. When they gave people those marks. And then I think in one case, I think in one of Menace's fiscal years, I think he tried to create a cultural grant of up to $1 million.
He did try.
Yeah, he did try. Yeah.
Well, he did say.
He did say. Yes.
You know, so much about trying. Yes.
Well, you got to remember, sometimes he's beheading out east.
Yes.
During background, he had a glass. 1, 2, 3, ABC.
Don't me.
Oh, my God.
Man, this is the world we live in. But aside from that, I think it's possible. And yeah, I'm glad that you've returned back to the stage. I used to feel very awkward for a very long time because I think even on my phone I had to change your name. I think fairly recently, the second before last time you were on the show, I think it was last year, or even if it wasn't last year, it was earlier this year, I had to change your name from Tada to Tranil, primarily because I had to like cement into my head, her name is Tranil, it is not Tada. And now I'm turning it back from Tanil back to Tadak. Actually, someone texted into the show.
Why don't you just interchange it? Is that okay?
I don't know.
See, I mean,
my brain
who's Philip Davis? I'm not sure, but I know who Philip Brave Davis is. So who's Tanil Tadak Burrows? There you go.
That's true. Yeah. My brain. See, the thing is, I when people someone said Philip Davis, I didn't even know what that was. It was like Brave.
I just called him Brave. That's it.
But that's kind of bad, you know, because in our Bahamian lexicon, we tend to remember people by the one name that's catchy. Like, unfortunately,
I mean, but is it really bad? It's kind of like a sense of community. You have a name that you call.
We call Perry Perry
because he doesn't really have another name.
That's true. I guess we call Ingram. Well, I call Ingram.
Unless his family calls him something different, it's not a name that his friends and everyone else calls him. Just Perry.
So like when people call Don Papa, Alexander.
Is that the thing we do with musicians regularly in the Bahamas? Well, though
that is.
Do we usually address musicians by
their
by
stage
one
names?
I think that is true because I don't say Exuma the old man, I say Exuma.
What KB name is Don?
Kirkland Booty.
But who knows that other than you?
Well, we're family apparently, so that's how I know because we're probably consistently.
We should do a survey.
We should actually.
Who is Kirkland Booty?
Who?
I just know him by KB. That's all. I didn't even know like.
You know what?
I've heard the name before, but that name really was not cemented in my head.
So the old man, which is like.
That's Exuma.
Exuma is his real name.
No, it's Tony McKay.
Tony McKay.
Wow. Extremely talented.
It's about branding as well. When you have that artist persona out there and people get familiar with it, that's they think of the entertainment. They think of the music behind the name as well.
Because
I actually, when I was on the same campaign trail as an independent candidate, I met a man who was like, yeah, man, I support the DNA. And after we spoke, when I was along with Ted, my right-hand guy on the campaign trail, and the guy was like, yeah, man, yeah, I like what you're saying, you know, but you got to get out there some more. You got to, like, you know, let your voice be heard and
what
blah,
does that
blah,
even
blah.
Mean?
And then my guy who was with me was like, she's Tada. And then this guy was like in his 30s. And he was like, this Tada? And I was like, yeah, maybe I should have put that on the ballot to Neil Tada Burrows.
Can you do that?
No.
No, you can't.
Oh, I mean, you can legally change your name and they have to.
No,
put
I'm not
going to
legally change my name, though.
Oh.
I think she has a good name to Neil Burrows. Why would she change it?
Thanks, Mark.
She isn't even planning on performing anymore.
Well, I ain't say that. I ain't say that.
She come back, man. She come back. Mr. Big, come back.
I ain't going to be all out and about. But my plan is to do stuff on a more international scale again.
Right.
Really.
I really hope that you do. I quite enjoy seeing Bahamians excel internationally because, unfortunately, we know how things is being when you're home. But I really do hope you get... and don't forget about us on the show. You ain't going to get us then, but just saying, you know, shout us out sometimes. And when you're back in town... Be no stranger to us, like you always have not been a stranger to us.
Thanks. And for people who are wondering, like, what do I sing? I can guarantee you 100% that you've heard my music.
Oh, we're going to play one of your songs you're going to break, actually.
It might not have been a song. It might have been a jingle like, The Shoe Village, Shoes for All.
I had no idea, actually.
What? I did not know that was you.
I always was to try to place the voice. And I was like, why does this voice sound so eerily familiar?
What? I wrote that song. Rick Carey did the music and produced it, and it's been around for 17 years and still going strong.
Still going.
They also are one of the corporate partners for the event, along with Tanya Simone Photography, Juju Tree Publishing. We've got Spotlight Lounge in Adelaide that's kicking up a fuss now. Great, great venue to see live music and have some great eats. We've also got Advocacy Advisors, Rise Bahamas. And can't forget, yes, it's Switcherific, my favorite Bahamian limeade. Yeah, they're presenting the concert along with me. Atlantis Theater on Saturday, December 10th. Tickets are available on Eventbrite.com.
I think we're going to keep letting people know. Now, of course, if you go on, if they go on Eventbrite, how do they search it up? Because they see...
You put in TADA, which is Tada, on Eventbrite. If you want to inquire about a VIP meet and greet access, you can email getmusicpro@gmail.com. I'll repeat the email address again, so get your typing finger ready soon.
Broken and brown, bomb, bomb, but down. Now, oh, I have to ask now, because I see all that little VIP things. You know, it's talking about now, so... I can still get the VIP thing or no?
Sorry, what?
Your VIP tickets, no?
You can get them by emailing getmusicpro@gmail.com. You can get the information, the cost, the
everything,
breakdown and all that.
I've actually, I'm going to sound extraordinarily, I'm going to say I'm going to sound extraordinarily behaving. I've actually never been to a concert in a hotel. Actually, that's not true. Do we technically count live comedy, stand-up comedy or no? Is that technically?
You said concert, though.
You're right. Okay, that's not a concert. You're correct. Never been to a live concert. So if I were to go, what can I expect?
All right. As a general admission person or a VIP person?
Let's go through both.
All right. So 6:45 p.m., we're going to kick off the VIP meet and greet. Going to have some music by Vice Versa Band, who are often at Spotlight Lounge in Adelaide. You're going to be able to kind of mingle with me and other people who are at the reception, have a couple of hors d'oeuvres and a beverage. I'm going to give you two CDs of mine, which are now relics, because you can't find them anywhere except from me directly, unless you go on iTunes and that thing. But these are going to be like physical CDs, and you're going to have an opportunity to get a photograph with me as well for your files. The general admission concert starts at 8 p.m. We're going to kick it off with Shad Furr, who is an actor, singer, songwriter. He's been in Shakespeare productions. He's recently in The Landlord that played at the Dundas. Going to kick off with some comedy, then do some of his music. Then we're going to segue into Tabby Burrows, my cousin, who's written for John Legend. And I judged her in a talent show when she was like 16. She's acted, also performed, obviously been on major network television on NBC for Songland, which is the music contest that she won, because she ended up getting to do a song for John, writing a song for John Legend through that show. Then I'll headline, and it'll be a mixture of some performances from tracks, performances with the now named Sweet Melody Band. Shout out to Ricky, Mateo, Josh, and what's the last name now? Joey. And we'll have like videos talking a little bit about Rise Bahamas, showing you some of the live videos, and maybe launching a new Tada song by video.
Maybe, possibly.
Maybe, yeah, possibly. We can see. Potentially.
We can see.
More than likely.
So you say it starts at 8. What time do doors open?
It starts at 8. So come at 7:45.
Okay.
That's when the VIP.
That's not Bahamian time. That's Atlantis time.
Yeah, well, you know. Some people never thought I was a Bahamian artist, so we could go with the not Bahamian.
What? Wait, really? Someone texted in and they said, big ups to Tada, one of the best Bahamian artists this country ever had. One love, Mega.
One love, Mega.
Yes. So, no, even when I was a child, like I said, well, I'm saying child, when I was in high school.
I'm still shocked that the Shoe Village jingle is her. Like, I remember hearing that, and like the moment she sang it, I'm like, oh, I know this.
It's actually one of those jingles. It's like one of three jingles that's like permanently burned into my memory.
Yes.
As a child catching the bus or like driving the car.
On the way to school.
Everywhere.
On the morning,
it's like that and the one for the, oh, anytime is the right time for where. Yeah. She didn't say that, but that's like burned into my memory. The incident happens, I subconsciously find myself singing the jingle. And I always say to myself, what is wrong with me? So now you're a part of that process. You're burned into my memory today.
But actually, that is not my biggest jingle. That's my biggest.
What else have you done? Wrong question. I want to hear another jingle that you have done, even if it's international. Of course, you can send me that off here. Because I'm very curious.
I can tell you right now.
Oh, go ahead.
It's Better in the Bahamas.
Can you sing it for a second? This little tiny.
You trying to remember?
Yes.
It's better in the Bahamas.
Yep.
Romance all the day.
Yeah.
How do I not know these things?
You don't know that?
No, I know the song. I mean, how did I not know this was you this entire time?
I'd be on stealth moves.
She'd just be running, making the stealth money, just not telling nobody that. Just like.
Did you grow up in a very creative family?
Oh, yeah. My dad was a songwriter. He used to lead the songs in church at Grace Gospel Chapel. They had this contemporary Christian group called Touch Productions. We used to like harmonize in the church just for the regular services. So that's when my musical career really started. I graced the stage at 4 with my dad, I believe. Then my granduncle on my mom's side is Lou Adams from the Lou Adams Orchestra, who used to play at Life Key and all these different places. So I get it from a double whammy. Pop, pop.
Yeah, you have like what's the word I'm looking for? The, not background is the wrong word. You have a lot of support in the home structure. And I think that's something we need to advocate more for. Not just that, but also encourage to pursue the things that they actually kind of want to pursue.
That's the thing. I want to shout out my parents and family for when I said I want to be a recording artist, songwriter. Them not saying, what the heck? You better go be an accountant.
They didn't laugh at you.
I mean, they didn't make me get my real estate license, but yeah.
That's kind of better.
Let's have a backup.
Yeah, they said like,
yeah,
you know,
said backup.
Get a little thing on the side while you're doing your little thing versus parents to be like, no, you're going to be a lawyer.
And then I want to definitely shout out the people that helped me to go to music business school, the organizations, Life at Key. I'm a proud Life at Key Foundation scholar, as well as SG Ambrose. And again, the Charitable Arts Foundation. They all contributed towards my music industry education. So I appreciate that.
Absolutely excellent. One more time, Tina, can you let people know how they can get tickets, what time the concert starts for those just tuning into the station? How can they... Just walk them through the process again. You say you go to Eventbrite first?
If you're ordering general admission tickets, which are $45, you can go and get them on Eventbrite. Just type in TADA, TADA, and you should see the event pop up. If you're interested in the VIP, you can email getmusicpro@gmail.com. And we can go from there.
Brogadum bram 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 bram. I'm going to do some more shout-outs before the show is over, obviously, to get the word out to people that people know. Madam Producer, you know what time it is. We're going to take a quick and fast. I was going to say fassy fassy. Are you going fassy fassy commercial? I don't know. I remember one time when I caught a plane before, and this little kid was sitting on the side of me, and he was just like, when the plane was taking off, go fassy, fassy, fast. So that's burned into my memory as well, just like those jingles.
Faster, faster, faster.
So we're going to take a quick commercial break. Stay right to it on the Eye Opener, your weekly dose of something different. That man you got is a bum bum. What a bum bum, what a bum bum. All you good for BT gum gum. What a bum bum. You think he in it for the long run? When he really, really only wants some. And maybe I sound redundant. But that man you got is a bum bum. What a bum bum, what a bum bum. All you good for BT gum gum. What a bum bum. Don't be silly woman with a bum bum. Don't yes, he want one, but he can't hold an apartment. What a bum bum, what a bum bum. Yeah, all he get for BT gum gum. What a bum bum. You think he in it for the long run? When he really, really only wants some. And maybe I sound redundant, but that man you can... Hold on, hold on, hold on, hold on. Wait till this game finish, eh? All he get for BT gum gum. Don't mind me sitting here, no, I got this. Don't be silly. Up to get settling, don't mean to be meddling. I just see where you heading in. Ain't pretty when a guy don't try, just ain't cute. I ain't gonna lie, what you waiting for? Buddy, you should get sipping on by. Let me break it down, but bye. Why you gotta act that way? If your mama knew just how you behave, yo, she'd be spinning in the grave. Huh? Oh, me, oh, me, oh, my. Don't break down, please don't cry. Thank you.
look at those investment options yet.
Too busy. Look at today. Workout, breakfast, drop kids at school, back-to-back meetings, dog from the groomer, nails, and that's all before 12. How come you're so chill?
That's because my money is as busy as you.
At RF, we find the best Bahamian and international investments to keep your money busy so you can spend more time focusing on you. Contact us at rfgroup.com to find out more. RF, money at work.
A local paper in Grand Bahama is back every Tuesday as a section of the Atha Guardian. Available at local stores, gas stations, pharmacies, Western Bakery, and Bellevue Gifts. Daily and, of course, on Tuesdays too. Want to reach your Grand Bahama audience? Then call Barefoot Marketing at 827-4578 or message them for ad rates via their Facebook page. Advertising opportunities now include classified ads too. Keep up with all the latest Grand Bahama news in the Guardian newspaper every Tuesday.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
I used to think of the bank as my personal ATM machine. If I wanted a new car, new furniture, a weekend trip to Miami, no problem. Just max out the credit card or top up my loan. I was a big baller until I realized that 75% of my salary was going to pay back all those loans. Fidelity's personal financial coaching was the best solution. Fidelity gave me a plan with a debt consolidation loan that has a built-in savings that pays 5% interest. I now only have one low monthly payment, plus money in my pocket. Give Fidelity Bank a call at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit any of Fidelity's locations or visit a website at fidelitygroup.com.
Love the show? Want to give your support? Become a sponsor today. Call 302-2300 for our rates and packages. That's 302-2300. Become a sponsor on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
Yes. And good morning to the eye opener. I'm just kidding. Good morning. Welcome to the eye opener. We need to know something absolutely positively different. If you're just tuning in, we're in studio with Tada, otherwise known as Tunil Burrows or Tunil Tada Burrows, right? I got to start saying that now. Like,
call Tada?
People, put the name in the middle with the little. That's apostrophe A. I think that's an apostrophe A, put in the middle of that. See, I do good at
that. No, the single quotes.
Yeah, that's the apostrophe thing, right?
I wouldn't need apostrophe, single quotes.
I know, man. That's public policy and thing, man. Y'all fellas, good with it. I saying that like I don't do the same thing as
exactly
Tate, right? That's a whole other conversation with consultancy. Anyway, good morning. Welcome to another beautiful Saturday morning. The song you heard before you went on break is actually one of Tada's singles, right? That is actually Tunil, who's in studio with us. You know something? I got to say this. Something I've always noticed is you can't tell, at least I can't tell if someone can sing based on hearing their voice, right? Because people perceive that I can sing, but I have an absolutely terrible voice and I can't hold a note to save my life.
What? Jesus loves me. Go. Go. Come on. You can do
Jesus
it.
Jesus loves me. Yeah, see? Terrible voice, right?
Were you trying, though? You weren't
no,
trying.
No, he was not trying. But he just said the words.
Apparently, everybody can, like, sing.
I can't sing. Horrible. You could hold
you
could
get that trained. I was in, like, choir, like, in my like second year at UB, I hated it, but I joined because someone asked me to join.
It was a gal who asked me to join.
Wow.
Yeah, I didn't know why you're trying to hide.
I'm not trying to hide anything, right? But yeah, it was a horrible experience. I didn't like it.
You didn't like singing?
No, it was like, it's not the fact that I didn't like singing. I don't like the people in the choir at the same time.
That's what happens when you join for the wrong reason.
No, but it's like the people were like very judgmental. I'm like, why are you like this? Like, I'm just trying to like enjoy myself here. Why are you judging me? I'm a new person here. And then after like a month, I just left.
I have to confess that music is, while I can't sing very well, I can't play an instrument. Mm-hmm. I need to go practice trumpet again. Trumpet and trombone were main instruments, also the piano, but then you lose your finger strength when you don't play, and you lose your lip strength when you don't blow. Pause. so we have very mischievous texters who love to troll. But I was going to say that music is something that we do not take seriously, but at the same time, we take extremely seriously. And someone posted something on Facebook that just I had to stop and think about, and I've been thinking about it all week ever since I read it, was that have you ever thought about how many Bahamian men casually can play a musical instrument extraordinarily well? And
listen to me. I've been around the world and I heard musicians from across the globe, and Bahamian musicians could play de bongi off.
Listen.
Agreed.
I was so accustomed to going to like an open mic or whatever, and Bahamian musicians or just in a rehearsal, letting them listen to something right quick and they come up with their own sound and could back you. I was so used to that when I went to Atlanta to open mic and I was like, hey, play this. And they're like, huh? And when I was in Toronto and recording my music video and I was like, play this. And they were just like not getting it. I was like, where are my good old Bahamian band members are, man?
That's what it is.
For true, Bahamians got talent, my boy.
I went to South Andres Pogombe Festival. There's this little boy. His dad is a drummer. And his dad went to do something. I can't remember what it was, but he left. And he called his son to come and play the drums. Listen, the best drummer ever. Shout out to them in South Andres right there.
I actually think we have something very interesting in our country. And that is this whole idea of playing by ear, mm-hmm. which sounds, most classically trained musicians would tell you that's a terrible thing. We're not say that. They discourage it and encourage you to, at least my music teachers have always done that, encourage me to stick to reading the music. Of course, you need to learn to hear it and understand where you're going with it, especially when playing in a group. But you need to stay classically disciplined in the art of reading music. And I had a music teacher that actively discouraged me from doing junk canoe, because he said usually junk canoe groups, not all, but for the most part, they may have some sheet music that they arrange for a song, but after y'all play it so many times, they can make changes to it, and you can stop reading that music, and you can just play everything by ear. And I was like, oh, let it be straight. So I did rush junk canoe, and I think for the first 2 weeks, he was reading off sheet music, and then after that, I just was like, we ain't no sheet music no more. And they started making these changes to the song, putting the chorus this place and moving this that place. I'm moving a bridge someplace else. And I got to the point where I didn't need to shoot music anymore to read to keep up with anybody. I developed my ear even better. But then, after I did junk canoe and everything, because you can't hand on, right? You have to feel your... It sounds very crazy, but when you're playing the trumpet, because the tubas and trombones are behind you, and they are blasting full blast behind your ear. I couldn't hear myself playing, but I could feel whether or not I was playing the correct notes. And it started to become this thing where you become in tune with your own instrument, the music. So anywhere I went and someone was like, oh, but play this. Once I heard the melody, is like all of a sudden, like this thing took over my body and I just knew what to do. But then after that, reading music was a bit of a struggle because I was like, I can't feel or hear anything to go off of. It's like I just reading off a piece of paper. It's very bizarre. But I was going to say, I thought that was a universal thing. Oh, no, it's not. We had this British guy when I was doing, I think, my Royal Schools exams, who came down and talked to us. And he played the saxophone, another string instrument. And he was talking essentially about the fact that, just like I said, so many Bahamians casually can play instruments just randomly. But that's not a thing where he's from. No one does that.
I don't know how to read music. I don't know music theory.
See? We just go off of music feeling, and it seems to work because it is about rhythm,
right? I mean, it would be nice. It would probably be helpful to know music theory. It'll expand your, you know, depth in terms of music, but I don't know how to read music.
They say the best way to develop your musical ear is to listen to music.
I'm not a trained dancer. I didn't go to any dance school anywhere in the Bahamas. I didn't take any Royal School exams. I joined a club in high school and found my love from there. And so, expanded my knowledge of dance doing that.
How does this royal thing work? Like, what is that?
Royal School's a
music.
It's the RSA exams. It's them and the Trinity. That's in the UK. It's them and Trinity schools who do these music. These are musical theory exams. Mm-hmm. They also have a practical component to it, but that's one of the conversation. Well, I did those. I did well on them. But I'm just saying I like you don't really take it in or really think about the fact that there's so much talent just lying around, and that this is in fact not a very normal thing for most countries.
Yeah,
that this is something special about this, but we just take it for granted.
As far as my music, I just rig it up.
That's how most good music is made. It isn't by doing research and was like, well, I determined that the third chord. I'm just kidding. We have a caller. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Yes, good morning.
Morning. What's happening?
Not bad. You know, I'm from a kind of musical family, right? I had two brothers that played professionally, you know, with Jay Mitchells and the Smokies and the like. One is in New York now and one is still here. You know, I have two sisters that they music, one of them was music teacher and one played with the police and sing with the police band, so they would be professionals. As well as I had some nieces, they're pretty good vocalists, real good, you know, but I have a problem with musicians in the Bahamas, and that especially the music in the Bahamas, you know, the lyrics specifically, right? They are, there's just no, activism in the lyrics, you know. I long for the day when we have lyrics from like musicians like Bob Marley, you know, and you remember when Bob Marley strayed, when his fans figured he strayed from the lyrics and went into the romance, so too much to the romance, they had a problem with it, you know, but he really didn't, you know. And Bob Marley, he didn't only sing the activism. He put his money where his mouth was. He fed many, you know, in the Jamaican community, the poor people. Mm-hmm. You see, I feel like we need some activism in our music, you know, and our Bahamian musicians. You know, we have a great opportunity in the Bahamas. We have a lot of musicians that you know, because of the junk, you know, and then too, I think they need to step it up, you know, the instrumentalists with the jazz and the like. And I feel like the jazz is the foundation, you know, that of all music. And Bahamas have a great opportunity to deal with this, you see? And in terms of the activism, you know, even to Dar, right? I feel like she needs some activism. She should have some activism in her music because she's an activist. You know, and then activism in the Bahamas, you know, with that being said, has a great issue, a big issue with me, because it seems not to be true activism in that, you know, we have no sense of people like FDR, the New Deal. It seems like we run away from it,
we gotta discuss it right now, caller.
I'm just saying activism in general in the Bahamas.
No, we understand. But
yeah, it's sick, man. You know, it disturbs me, man. We are so conservative in this country. It's
not all of us, caller. Not all of us are conservative.
I mean, generally.
But I understand why you say that.
Everybody, man.
But there's something we gotta discuss that right now. Actually, thank you so much, caller.
Yeah, I mean, to that.
I just wanted to say today. I know you have a response to that about the. I'm sure you do. Response to the.
I think the song should speak for itself.
Yes. Well, Tada actually does have a lot of activism in her.
But I think it depends on what you're looking for. If you're looking
but thanks for telling me what I need to do.
I think if you want to compare it to Bob Marley's or to Bob Marley's music, something that's something that you're looking for specifically in Bahamian music, you won't be able to find it because that's specific to Bob Marley's music. Musicians are different and the message in their music is different. If you look at artists like Ronnie Butler and stuff, yeah, you may think, oh, he just playing, but it's a different type of activism going on. He may... Him talking about, what song is it? Is it Bang? I don't want to say it on air. But is it Bang Bang Lulu?
Mm-hmm.
He's bringing awareness to something deeper inside of our communities inside the Bahamas. Most of his music is something deeper. So it's a different social activism at work there in his music. If you go and you speak about, as she defined Bahamian music, it's not just, you know, the rake and scrapes and stuff, but it's also Bahamians who make music. If you listen to the rappers, to Twin Them, the Shadfers, you will hear activism inside of a lot of their things, but you are... Sometimes, you know, you get stuck because you like a particular artist and the type of music that they make. You kind of are looking for that artist in other artists.
Ah, yes. It's kind of like expecting What they say now, say y'all just listen to Burger Burger Eyes, listen to X, Y, Z.
Right. Like,
no, y'all get the same thing everywhere. But someone texted in. It's like you can by texting us in at 422-GR96-24796. This one's a little roasty-toasty. But I'm going to read it anyway because we don't censor. We censor it, so it could be on radio, but we try to read all the text. Someone says, oh, my God, tell this ridiculous old man to make the darn activism music. Jesus, WTF. Read that, please. And it's like, I've read it, texter. but, yes, again, we're very open to people expressing their opinions on this show. I find it interesting, too, that... the person who just texted, they're saved in the phone is morning plan. That's anyway, moving on. No, I just never saw a name just stuck in the thing before ever. It's always just numbers. Anyway, that's fine. I'm not pointing at anybody there. But I just wanted to say on the musical point, I have to commend you, yourself, and every other artist that I've ever met because there is always a wall of skepticism around music in terms of its economic viability in the country. And usually, this is a statement I've heard made by students from adults, well, I mean, we're all adults, right? But students, older Bahamians, etc., that the... I'm trying to find a politically correct way of saying this. But in essence, that if you go into music, you're probably unstable. I'm not saying that it is the case, but I've heard people say this. And I've always wondered, how do people break through that? If the stigma comes from both the parents, sometimes friends and family, and just general adults around you as a child or as an adolescent or a young adult. And I always look at persons who stuck. Almost every musician or artist I've ever met in my life have all told me about those stories, but they usually have a backing of, not all the time, but most of the time, with their parents or someone within their family from the beginning of the process, encouraging them, for them to even make it to that point. Was that your experience?
Yeah, when I grew up, I had this feeling that I could be whoever I wanted to be and do whatever I wanted to do. So I always liked the fun stuff. Music, sports, art, those are my favorite things. I don't know why I ended up taking the sciences in high school. I think that was an experiment.
Mandatory or something?
It was an experiment on my part. Like, let me see.
Some accounts and
I was
economics.
In Dushabe in school, so I was
thinking about that. I should have done some accounts and economics. That's a life skill right there. Yeah. I wish I did.
It's quite boring.
But I think I wrote a plan at 17 of what I wanted to do and accomplish in 5 years, and it was mostly related to music. And I 5 years later, I had accomplished more than that. When I was 20, I won the hip-hop category of the John Lennon Songwriting Contest, which was hosted by Yoko Ono and judged by people like Wyclef Jean and others. So that affirmed me because I was like $15,000 worth of prizes and an opportunity to have an EMI music publishing deal, which was a major music record company, a publishing company back in the day, which I declined. But suffice to say, I think that if I had gotten that deal or taken that deal, I probably would have become more invested in the music industry than I am now, and I might not have ever really become an activist or an advocate. So I appreciate that I didn't take that opportunity in retrospect, even though, you know, it was enticing.
Well, I'm glad that you did. As always, it sounds mystifying to me to hear about all the things that happened for you when you went off and all the grants and such, because those things sound so foreign to my Bahamian ears, because when I think
you're cynical Bahamian ears.
Yes, because when I hear grants, it seems like the only people who get grants. I mean, I'm knocking anybody, but it seems like the grants are for business ventures now, which we didn't have that in the past. So I'm grateful for that happening because a lot of people that I know have benefited from it. But it's just hearing anything invested in culture is usually putting on a performance for one particular event, and then that's the end of it. And hearing about how different places handle this issue and encourage and essentially spur growth within the orange economy gives me hope that, you know, it's not impossible to do because other people have already done the same thing. But
I would venture to say that in Jamaica, for example, their creative industry and entertainment industry paved the way for their tourism industry, because once Bob Marley made it big with his reggae sound, people started to recognize him as Jamaican. And as a result, we have suffered this mistaken identity thing in the Bahamas and even throughout the Caribbean, because Jamaica was so well branded with reggae and Bob Marley and others. of that time, they heard the Jamaican accent. And when they heard anything near to it from the Caribbean, you go in, you know, you in Canada, you in the States, you anywhere, and they say, oh, I hear your accent. You from Jamaica? Music did that.
Yeah, man.
Music put Jamaica's tourism on the map.
So what you're saying is we could take most of that travel budget and put like a good chunk of that into the arts so we could not have to travel as much, but essentially the work of Bahamians will be doing the traveling for us.
It will take the world stage, rake and scrape the people who are advocating for that to become a genre that is known around the world. We can invest in that prospect and see how it goes. Look at where Afrobeat is now. For years, it's been bubbling under. You've been doing Afrobeat collabs with some major artists. Now it's to the point where that's what's bussing. That's what's happening. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, let's invest in making rake and scrape big throughout the world.
If you think about it, most people know who let the dogs out.
Mm-hmm. That's, yeah.
That's the Bahamas.
Partially Junkanoo.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't know that Bahamian are Bahamian. I've asked a number of international people, oh, you know, like as I travel around the world, you know, Bahamian is Bahamian, right? That's why they call it Bahamian. It's like, oh, who let the dogs out? No, I didn't know that. Just like you didn't know I did. You know?
But not everybody watches a music video. That's like, I mean, they hear it on the radio. They hear it in a
the time it came out.
Or a movie.
Yeah.
Oh, Lord.
But when you look at Bahamian as an example, like, because I feel like we need to invest in our local talent instead of always being plucked from here by foreign executives, because the foreign executives, they develop the acts and release the songs and the hits, but they make the vast lion's share of the profits. So at the end of the day, you have Bahamian Grammy Award winning singer producing my jingle in the Bahamas for peanuts.
Yeah. But we can change that. Big things. I'm confident that we can change that. It doesn't have to stay this way for the rest of eternity. And I think us consistently talking about this and advocating on this behalf, and potentially, who's the good minister of youth sports and culture?
Mari Boleh.
Is it still youth sports and culture with those things?
It's still youth sports and culture.
Okay, still great. Under there.
Well, apparently the Minister of Foreign Affairs, Fred Mitchell, had a big speech related to the whole how Tony McKay was the subject of this film called Nope or something.
Yes, he was in Nope. Yes, he was in Nope.
Yeah, Fred Mitchell had a lot to say about that and a lot to say about how...
Well, it's based around the song.
Yeah, okay. So he said how creative industries are so important and this and yada, yada. So now we have the evidence to use in the court of law when we go to them and make our case for a music industry in the Bahamas to be developed.
I was also going to say it's... We get problems saying this, but I don't care. He's that's a good point. I was going to say, but you also have to take ownership of the fact that it was under the tenure of that political party that this music industry died, and the push for tourism accelerated under that party as well. And I don't think enough consideration was made. Some people said it was malicious. Some people said it was deliberate. But here we are. That this has happened, where we talked about the situation with Hotas plucking them out of the nightclub scene and essentially eroded and destroyed much of the domestic economy. And that's more of the tourist economy isn't something that Bahamas really participate in. Although we like to say that we do, most of the money is extracted out of the country. But that's a whole other debate.
Now, 85%, from what I recall, 85% of money that we make from the tourism industry leaves this country.
And notice all the roads that are nicely paved go to and from the hotels.
When I was in Bimini?
I mean, the airport. Go to and from
the airport. Yeah, the airport and hotels.
To the hotels.
Another interesting fact, we have such an
except for East Bay Street.
We have a huge income inequality gap in this country.
Yes.
So you have multi billionaires that reside here, and then you have dirt poor people who subsist off of less than $4,500 a year. At least 43,000 of them, there was reported in 2013.
Yep.
That is huge. That's 11% of the population. And then we round the place talking about we some like, and then the cost of living in the Bahamas is apparently third in the world, highest.
Yep.
It's the same as Switzerland, and we make a third.
But what we getting for, like, I know what Switzerland is be dealing with and how their roads looking, how their educational system set up.
Great
what
health
be
getting
system looking.
Because at the end of the day, I could be pushing for child protection and local government and all this stuff, but at the end of the day, the situation we're in where we have the haves and the haves nots, and where there are no opportunities for young men in particular, we got to focus on these 18 to 25-year-old young men. They're the ones with the highest murder rates and also victims of murder, like, I really feel like if we develop this creative industry and tell them, look, drop the guns, pick up the mic, let's see what we could do, that it's possible.
I like that. Can you get one more time before we go to break again, Tina? Can you give us the info? People want to purchase tickets, you can say check Eventbrite.
Eventbrite.com is where you can get the tickets for Saturday, next Saturday, December 10th at Atlantis Theater. Or you can also email getmusicpro@gmail.com for VIP ticket access info for the meet and greet.
All right. Thank you so much. We're going to do some more shout-outs, for, especially at the end of the show, to let people know to keep the word out. We're going to take a commercial break. Tenille, thank you so much for, I guess, gracing us with your presence today in studio. It's always a pleasure to see you and to have you in studio. We got to talk more about, I mean, I know we're going to focus on advocacy right now, but we got to talk way more about that in the new year. I guess we need to have an advocacy push in the country to elevate those voices especially. But we shall be right back after this.
Every day they've been betrayed with no one to protect them. I can't watch this from the sidelines. I gotta fight this, I gotta try. I'm feeling outrage every day by all the children and so much pain. And if you didn't know, let me help you find out. A child needs your help and they need it right now. They're counting on us and we can't let them down. Listen to the words coming out of my mouth. We won't rest until we see. We won't rest until we're sure this is the end of it. When everything is said and done, no one will be alone. We won't rest till every child is safe and sound at home. Oh, I won't rest till every child is safe and sound. What do you do when home ain't safe anymore? When it's so hard to trust anyone. It's so hard to hear. I've been abused. I've been broken and bruised. I've been mistreated and used. I've been hurt and confused. I don't know what to do now. I can't watch this from the sidelines. I gotta fight this. I gotta try. I'm feeling outrage every day by all the children and so much pain. And if you didn't know, let me help you find out. A child needs your help and they need it right now. They're counting on us and we can't let them down. Listen to the words coming out of my mouth. We won't rest until we see change and justice. We won't rest until we're sure this is the end of it. When everything is said and done, no one will be alone. We won't rest till every child is safe and sound. We won't rest.
We won't give you we see the offenders no rest.
We won't rest.
We won't give you those that sit in this very house.
When everything is said and done.
Love the show? Want to give your support? Become a sponsor today. Call 302-2300 for our rates and packages. That's 302-2300. Become a sponsor on Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
I used to think of the bank as my personal ATM machine. If I wanted a new car, new furniture, a weekend trip to Miami, no problem. Just max out the credit card or top up my loan. I was a big baller until I realized that 75% of my salary was going to pay back all those loans. Fidelity's personal financial coaching was the best solution. Fidelity gave me a plan with a debt consolidation loan that has a built-in savings that pays 5% interest. I now only have one low monthly payment, plus money in my pocket. Give Fidelity Bank a call at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit any of Fidelity's locations or visit a website at fidelitygroup.com.
The holidays are a time for reflection on the year past, reconnecting with family and friends, and indulging in brand new experiences. No matter what your holiday may bring, at Reb, we want to remind you to do it together. Play together. Watch together. Be together. Take time this Christmas to connect with the people and things that really matter. And let Reb take care of home for the holidays. Merry Christmas, Bahamas!
There it is.
Wait! Find what you love and let it kill you. Sharp under pressure, thinking damage.
Welcome back to the Eye Opener, where your eyes are open, and we are the openers of the bottles. It's been a beautiful Saturday. We just had the song you heard earlier is actually another song by the amazing Tada. It's actually one of her newest song, a newest song. It's her latest release, if I can say that word. Whenever I hear the word latest release, it always comes out to like, I always think of the news, where it's like, the latest, you know what? No one's everybody doing the whole thing. But yes, we're going to play some more of her songs before the show is out. Again, you can get tickets for her concert on Eventbrite if you wanted to check that out. I think the concert is happening December 10th. It's happening at the Atlantis Theater. So hit up those tickets on Eventbrite. You can just type in Tada and you can find your tickets. And we're also going to shout out before the end of the show, absolutely. Actually, something I just remembered, guys. Y'all remember the Rainforest Theater before they essentially blew that
demolished
building up?
Demolished it, yep.
Yeah,
they don't even know what that is.
Oh, if you don't know, it was a theater in, what was Crystal Palace?
Mm-hmm.
That's where I watched my first stand-up comedy show.
Wasn't Crystal Palace like blew up or imploded? Like,
yes, they blew it up. Yes, yeah, to demolish it. They put bombs in it and then...
Was it right before COVID or before Dorian?
That was during the pandemic.
I think it was during the pandemic.
I remember someone I knew had a wedding on the beach there, and like before they blew up the building, obviously, and like I think that was where they housed all the Chinese workers, laborers, and they were just all like had their clothes drying out on the thing and was watching the wedding with us. And I was like, wow, this is interesting that no one talks about this. But anyway.
Oh my God.
Go ahead.
Have you guys ever driven past the
point? Sand trap? Yes.
Oh my.
Sorry, go ahead.
That's what you call it? That's what it's called? You said the point? By the point, yeah. Right across the street from Margaritaville.
Oh, yes.
That's a hotel?
It was years and years and years and years ago, I believe.
And that's housing for people?
Yes. That's what it's turning into.
It's housing, I think, maybe the persons that are working on the U.S. Embassy. Possibly.
Listen.
That's coming along well.
The U.S. Embassy, yeah. Boat, yes. Dude, that building is ginormous.
That's going to be amazing, I'm sure.
Imagine working in that building. Mm-hmm. That'd be crazy. Maybe you need security clearance to go everywhere.
Yeah.
We could be working there when they take.
Never mind.
You won't be allowed on the ground floor though. That's only for U.S. citizens.
Oh wow!
Did you see how deep they had to dig? That's into...
I thought they were like putting a nuke in there or something.
Exactly.
That's obviously going to be a basement for safety.
A basement for safety.
I think that's going to be one of the biggest embassies in the region. Biggest U.S. embassy.
So is it going to be like a satellite or something?
A satellite?
Yeah, like a satellite embassy. Like so, press from different countries going to come here to get this stuff sorted out.
Oh yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah, that's the intention. There's only two in the Caribbean, and we're one of them. And considering how small the current
Where's
U.S.
Where's the second
is,
one?
Is it Jamaica? Jamaica,
I don't know why, but I doubt it, but maybe.
Yeah, it's actually, you know what? I'm not going to discuss the politics of how that thing works before I cause problems. Mm-hmm. Please, I love my visa. Don't take that away. moving on. We wanted to do a bit of a recap this. Well, we started. We're going to call it, I was going to say 4 days of Christmas, but kind of like 4 days. But however, how many days, mm-hmm. right? We wanted to do basically a...
Barbados, I think.
Barbados? Okay, yes.
Yeah, it is Barbados. Yeah, I remember now.
The Nassau is one of them as well. Mm-hmm. People do fly here to get their visas and stuff sorted. It's actually amazing. You just stand on the line by the Mickey D's. And you just look at the people coming in, listen to the accents and languages that they speak, and you'd realize, huh, this could be...
Koblen.
I know, right? Yeah. Because it's easier to get at certain places. Not, mm-hmm. not going there. But yes, I was going to say, we wanted to do the year in recap. So many things happened this year, like this week, for instance, with our good friend Kanye West having an absolute... I don't know what it is.
I don't think it is meltdown. I think it's just him being him now.
Mask off.
Yeah, I think the last high for him was one of the highs that I remember for him was like when he had the Yeezus album, and he had all those references to God.
Absolute trash.
I don't think it was trash.
I hated that album.
I enjoyed it. Mm-hmm.
I was scratchy noises the whole album.
I think I was like 12 or something at the time. I don't remember, but it was like. You know, he made those references to God, and people were like, "Oh, you're being like blasphemous, right?" But now it's like this is a new high for him. Like he's just been breaking barriers and stupidity and craziness over the last couple of years.
But here's the thing that makes it so absurd, right? This goes into a point that's going to get me in trouble, and I don't care. He can technically just say, "Ask God for forgiveness, and it's over."
Pretty much.
And there's nothing wrong with that. Actually, he told you about this before. I stumbled upon this YouTube channel.
You
want to
get some calls.
I know, right? I stumbled upon this YouTube channel. And this ties into a bigger point. This YouTube channel, and one of the ladies in the YouTube channel professed or confessed, I don't know, that she was an actress of sorts in the adult film industry. And I was so perplexed and confused because she has a Christian channel. And she was talking about her journey with Christ. Mm-hmm. And then I Googled her name and I realized, oh, no, she's very active. Mm-hmm. But it was her and her husband doing these videos about like their journey and the church they go to and where they pray. And I was like, I don't understand. How is this? And I checked her Twitter and I was like, oh, no, it's exactly what I thought it was going to be.
We're blurring the lines now.
Her job does not define who... her or her beliefs.
But this is what I was going to say about this is the dangerous... I'm not saying she's dangerous or what she's doing is dangerous. I'm just saying this is the dangerous part about religion, right? And the way that certain people practice it. And I'm not criticizing anybody. You can believe it if you want to believe. I don't care. You can believe the earth is flat, like our resident flat earther, I'm sure, is going to text in now. Is that there are no true... I don't want to use the word consequences, but it's kind of like people realize more and more that with this sort of system that there are no, I can't think of a better word, there are no real consequences for it. So you can just do anything and just be like, I want forgiveness. And the proof of that is you can embezzle millions of dollars in the Bahamas and then come right back and run again and probably win. Because it's like, what are the consequences? Then I could just say, well, only God could judge me. And it's like, I can't even say the court can judge you because then the police officers will just alter witness testimonies and just like fraud up the system.
And then you get promoted afterwards.
Yeah. So it's like, when I watched her video of her explaining her situation on YouTube, I was so perplexed and confused, but I was like, I can't be mad because the same duplicity that I am perceiving is the same thing that I live in every single day in this country where it's like this duplicitous thing. And so I was like, I just can't judge it. And I just walked away and I was like, I guess that's the end of it. And it's just that translates over to basically every gosh darn thing that we do in the Bahamas. Like we say, like Tadao was saying earlier, that we want this orange economy to grow. But then the deputy prime minister goes to a different country and then says, let's bring...
Oh, a theater festival here.
Theater festival for
while
America.
The theater festival just happened to be going at the same time.
And it's like, and then there's no consequences for that because you could just say, oh, I just misspoke. Mm-hmm. And it's like, babe, but then the people will be like, oh, okay, cool. I'm just like, this is a terrible thing to say. I just don't see the point, basically, to anything anymore. It's made me very nihilistic, I guess, in a way. And looking back at this year of the absolute absurdity of, like, outright lies, the whole entire FTX meltdown that we're apparently still going through, how is Sam Bankman-Fried doing all these interviews in Good Morning America and essentially to wash his image? And, like, it seems, and people say, oh, it's in court, you can't talk about it.
I think that he also wants to be CEO again. So I get the impression that this is not his final act, or that more so he wants to come back or redeem himself.
He's the Kanye of FTX.
Yeah.
And you know what I've learned? Mm-hmm. If Fitzgerald can come back, and if Shane Gibson can come back, and considering the absolute, like, volume of scandals and controversies, but the voting populace will likely not remember any of those things. And if Shane runs again, he's probably going to win his seat. I'm pretty confident he's going to win his seat. It doesn't matter. Like, you can do virtually anything and come back and do it again.
Well, you could tell somebody and just happen to be a chairman of a party, you know?
Yes, yeah. Or call people darkies that are heating up the place.
And then be Speaker of the House.
So it's like, we don't live in a country with values, man.
Yeah.
And I'm not roasting the country. I'm just saying it is what it is. And so when I look back at this year, I can't look back at this year and be outraged by anything anymore. All I can say is, no, this is exactly who we are. This is
we're on a course, right? And we have certain indicators, and those things are playing out as we see them.
You know what? I think to a certain extent, we don't really forget. We think as Christians, we believe that people can change and people can do better. So they may have made a mistake before.
Like Adrian Gibson. Potentially made a mistake.
Yes.
Allegedly.
Potentially made a mistake. And he can redeem himself. He can come back and, you know, prove that either that really wasn't him or something like that. So we believe that people can change. And you give them that opportunity to show us that, hey, I can change. I am a changed person. I can do better. I can be better.
Minnis could probably be prime minister again.
Isn't Donald Trump running again?
Yes.
Okay.
I think Minnis could potentially be prime minister at another time in this country.
Well, minister's trying. He's like 67 now, something like that, 65.
Okay, Brave in his 70s, almost 80.
Yeah, Brave almost 80, yeah. I don't want to see him as prime minister again, but that's another story.
If we could shuffle back and forth between Hubert Ingram and...
Geriatrics only apply.
Yeah.
...for years. I feel as though we could shuffle back and forth between Minnis and Brave.
Or Michael...
Michael Pintar?
Michael Pintar.
I think he might be... I think he might be our sixth prime minister. Maybe. I think so.
I think you're too young, man. We need him older than that. We don't do that.
Like
young.
70s? Like,
yeah, he needs to be in your 70s.
But we're not gonna appreciate him more until you reach up there.
Yeah, you gotta be in your 70s.
Because he ain't ripe yet.
Exactly.
He's still on the tree. Yeah,
he's still green.
Yeah, he's a little green. He look green. You know, you gotta wait till he get red.
I mean, he might get,
you know, backstabbed metaphorically, you know, by
somebody. Oh, yeah, more likely
it's going to happen.
Like,
but
have you thought about the fact that we had a Dorian concert this year?
Mm-hmm. That's crazy.
Y'all remember that?
I remember that.
Did not attend, but I remember.
The people in the 5 minutes didn't attend either.
It was a celebration. It was a celebration, not a commemoration. It was a celebration of Dorian, Hurricane Dorian.
Do you remember, the people were saying y'all could have just spend that money helping us rather than throwing a stupid concert.
The power literally goes off every day in Abaco still. The water turns off regularly.
Oh, yes. And Eleuther as well. Eleuther, that's the same situation.
I went to Harbor Island, literally my first day, power off and on every day. Water, you had to catch it when you catch it. I don't understand.
And then there's the issue of that Sears order. I think it was this week.
The
Sears order.
Sears? Oh, yes.
It ended on the 30th of November.
30th of November. And I was listening to the financial secretary, and it's like the reasoning that he was using didn't really make any sense to me. I don't think it was a fair comparison to make. Like, he was talking about how Nassau and other islands had to subsidize both Abaco and Grand Bahama.
But Nassau subsidizes the entire country with electricity, though. That's why electricity bills are so high. Like, you pay the same rate, I think, obviously, Freeport has their own electricity company, which is much lower than what we pay at BPL in New Providence. Mm-hmm. But we did everybody we subsidize everything. Like everybody pays their fair share for the system. But sorry, just go ahead.
Yeah, and it just felt like I don't know if that was a very good reasoning behind it. And I saw some comments of people like who were actually in the island saying that, you know, they lost time because of the COVID-19 pandemic to recover. So that put a dent in the recovery. And so I think they should be given more time, to be honest.
Kind of, oh Lord, that's a...
In all honesty, I feel as though we all need more time. With 2 years they gave us. No, a year. Because I feel like it's just a year. It's just been a year. And they gave all of us basically this 1 year to say, hey, recover. And then things just go back to normal.
Regular
Bahamians in New Providence probably would need, I would say, let's say two, 3 years. Let's at least. And then in the Family Islands in Abaco and Grand Bahama, they would need from 5 and up. Yes, to actually try and get things back to...
Perhaps we should have done it by income. So, like, if you everything was destroyed, like, you kind of lost your job, too. But if you make over a certain amount of money, like, you make over $110,000 a year, like, you don't get the same breaks anything at all as a person who makes under that.
I do know what he was suggesting was that also was certain persons who didn't deserve the tax breaks were getting the tax breaks.
Who decides that?
And so he was suggesting that what we do is that we get rid of it and make it by case-by-case basis. But knowing the government...
So that just sounds like, okay, so when... This is regular. Whichever government's in power, if it's the PLP or the FNM, when our PLP brethren get it, we can give it to them. When our FNM brethren get it, we can give it to them.
That's the thing. Like, someone made that point that... If you do that, then it's very much so open to political favor.
Yes.
So I think it's just to stay open at this point. Because I don't trust the government to monitor that properly.
It's the thing.
But did he say how they were getting, like people who didn't really need it were getting it? And the persons that are actually really needed, was it that application process?
He didn't really say. Approval
process?
See, that's the thing. It's just like everything else in government is shady and obscure.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
We have a caller. We see your dumb caller. Good morning, caller. You're on the air. Oh, we missed them. You can call back just like that person did. I think one of our lines is kind of...
Yeah, one of the lines is down.
Is doing a thing. So 3-2...
I think it's 6-2-3-2. Yeah, so is the one that's bad.
The first one. So you can call us in at 325-4316.
Because I do remember Aaron round somebody out about that.
Yes. Sometime earlier. 4-3-2-5-4-2-5-9. Let's try to take this call again. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Well, good morning, everybody. You know, I love this show. It's the best show on radio to identify problems in our country. And it uses sarcasm. But what the show doesn't do is tell us the solution. Because we're very good at talking about problems, but we're horrible with solutions. See, if we say, okay, for the rest of your life, no more tax, no more VAT, no more duty, that's a great idea from you. But I want to know, how do you expect the road to get tar, the water to stay on for the people who come and get free water? How do you expect to pay all these bills and the huge pensions? You never talk about that, or the salaries in a huge government. How do we pay for all of that?
We're going to deal with that right now, Graham.
Well, you know what? Let's come with some solutions instead of crying about the problems. You guys,
absolutely.
You sound angry. You sound like someone owes you something. Nobody wants to make...
All right, Graham, that's fine. That's fine for you to express your opinions. We're open to everybody expressing their opinions. We do have some texters, actually. Someone said... We're doing a recap of the year.
So we're talking about the year.
Yeah, things that have happened this year. So someone says, good morning. There's a whole generation who missed the leadership of being PM as someone in their 40s. I'll be down if I don't support a party leadership of persons in their 50s. Pintar Cooper only makes sense.
Who's Cooper?
Chester Cooper. Yes. I couldn't remember his first name for a second. He doesn't have a nickname, does he?
No, Chester.
Is this the end of the nicknames after Brave? Is that it? Is that everybody else?
It
just
seems like it.
Unless you call
him, because we get Minis a nickname.
Unless
you call him
Bobo Otogi.
Bobo. I think him on Brave was stealing
up and that.
Yes,
there's a lot of people that was up and that.
Murder for hire plug. Gosh.
Yeah.
That. And you know what? We came out of that situation. Probably the same thing that the international community, when I say that, I mean predominantly Americans on social media are saying it's probably going to come out of the situation with SBF.
FTX, yeah.
And SBF, yes, that nothing is going to essentially happen with that. Yeah. You remember we had that crypto...
crypto conference?
The crypto conference.
That's just going to, I think it just dampened our credibility. Well, do we have credibility in the first place? I mean, that's the question.
All Clinton and those were there, right? They were. Well, they were
is Clinton credible?
I can't respond to that. I can't respond to that. I don't know. Yeah,
you don't know. You don't know.
Because he has done some terrible things to Haiti.
But you can judge on Haiti, though, for sure.
Yes, you can judge. Yeah. He's done some terrible things in Haiti. Essentially destroyed their grain production by forcing him to import American grain mm-hmm. when he decided to intervene in Haiti. Was that Ariste? Who they also put on a helicopter on out of the country and then put him on a plane to some other country.
Oh, wow.
And then he found his way back to Haiti
eventually. Yeah, he's back in Haiti now, He's quiet as it is now.
Trying to make sense of the stupidity that they do to us in the Caribbean. Mm-hmm. Yes, but the FTX conference did happen this year, which is like this thing that's on repeat across social media as the biggest egg on the Bahamas' face. Mm-hmm. All the photo ops leaders of our country did with Sam Bankman-Fried. It's like we don't learn, you know. And I didn't know this was going to go the way that it did with the meltdown. But it's like we haven't learned from the situation of Peter Nygaard. We haven't learned from the situation of the guy from Iran. His name is Harachi. Mm-hmm. He used to be on it. It's like these stories consistently repeat themselves in this country of these. What is it? Not malignant. There's a word for it. Malevolent?
Malevolent or malignant?
Malevolent. They are presented like these malevolent like investors. Oh, angel investors.
Good people.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. And benevolent,
then,
yeah.
But it doesn't matter whether or not they are. I just think the proximity of government officials and these people is too close. And this year we watched another episode. This is Arcus, right? We watched another episode of just failure to,
you know, I wouldn't be surprised if that's how some of these parties basically do their fundraising.
Well, he was having parties at his house.
I think it was, I was reading something on WikiLeaks, somebody made a comment about how both of the parties spent like about $7 million on that campaign, in one election year, and then the person had noted that was kind of like abnormal to spend on the election. It's like, if you have that amount of money to spend,
but we don't know what's abnormal.
That's true.
That's another problem because we don't know campaign
finance laws. We don't know much things about this country, right? And so it's like
there's not enough data being generated.
And just last year, we found that whole carnival issue was actually a fundraising thing. We didn't know that, and then there was a question of was that corruption, right?
Well, at least we ended the lockdowns this year, right?
Yeah, that's all we did.
Last year, but I mean, mask mandate ended. Mm-hmm. Which was, there's still a mask mandate in schools, but I
think it ended. That ended.
Yeah. Oh, well, I haven't been seeing mm-hmm. that happening even when it was still a thing.
Now, I saw it. I live right across the street from a school. They were wearing, I mean, I can't tell you how they were wearing.
I was going to say, you go to a school too. Oh. And that wasn't a thing.
We thought it did not apply to us.
I'm telling you,
we thought it did not apply to us. We thought it applied to high schools, primary schools.
No, it applied to tertiary.
Did not know it applied to tertiary education.
Yeah, but I wasn't wearing it either. We do have another caller. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Press the button again.
Oh, we got to push it twice, eh?
Nope.
Okay, it's frozen. Okay. I do the thing. Thing and do I.
Okay. Oh, there it is.
Oh, there we are. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Yes, good morning. Did the eye open up?
Good morning.
Tate, Dawn, and sound like Aaliyah, right?
No.
This is
Stefano. Can't be DeAndre. Yeah, but anyhow, hello?
No, we're still there, man.
We're still there.
Yeah, you know, the thing is, I was listening, you know, it's always a great show, and so capping off the year. But firstly, those female singers, Dawn?
Yes.
I love them. Bo Dean and the lady you had on, right?
Yes, ta-da.
Anemus?
Ta-da. Tenille Burris, yeah. Ta-da.
And I want to ask a question. Who will sing the song 242, the song with the display on the commercial, 2022? One for me and something like that. I always like the female singers now. And all just basically all. And so in Bodie in with a guy named KB, them is singing some kind of political song, like they try to get people into
always
going on. So mm-hmm. I mean I agree with Gardner. We need more of that to really draw attention. But you know, some of them sound good. They really they make you feel is unique. Especially with the Reagan scrape. You see how some of the people are skanked to the Reagan scrape, man. I think it's a unique culture. And Scrooge was on last night. And Scrooge was given a very great idea on how to youth junking to empower the inner city youth. And I thought it was really, if who didn't listen to it, you know, has to be a fool, because I thought it was a brilliant idea. But I wanted to do a little quick recap on the subterfuged, right? How we were subterfuged. Remember, they told us that, but firstly, Dawn, a charismatic leader is needed, right? But it won't save us.
No.
If we as the people don't realize, right, that we need to save ourselves. We really need to save ourselves. You know, a charismatic leader, a great leader would help. You know, Tyndall is more charismatic. He's about the same age as me. I like Chester, but Chester speaks too monotonous. It's like,
yeah,
you know,
he's,
I mean?
He speaks boring.
It's
not, he's like me.
You know what I mean? And these guys are driven by.
It'd be worse than me.
And he putting on the concert. So I think he putting on the concert because the tickets starting to cash and go, et cetera, et cetera. But I wanted to get on to recap some things that I thought was clear and really criminal. First, they told us that the vaccines would bring back things to normal, right? You remember that take?
Yes.
Yeah, over the whole world, the global chief was fed the narrative that the vaccines would bring things back to normal, and then they said that you couldn't catch COVID if you got the vaccine. But common sense could have told me that there's no way that after you, the book, I got a joke for you. You want to hear it?
Go ahead.
All right, the book, The Great Reset, right? I can redub that The Great Setback. You pick up? Because that's what reset is. You know, I work in engineering. When you get the machine cut off and you reset it, it's like you're starting over. So it's not. That's what the reset is. It's a setback.
So you think
everybody breaking up and trying to catch up now, right?
You think the situation with the vaccines in the country, you kind of are you referencing basically how the whole push just dissolved and went away
for yeah, people Dawn, to get yeah, vaccinated? Dawn, the push. Listen to me, Dawn. But you're always rowing. Not you in particular. I'm just trying to be. You're always rowing 52 saying he didn't know the science and he didn't know what he was saying. But could you go back to the archives and show me once where I was wrong and what I was wrong about? I mean, no one is fastidious every time they speaks, right? But just show me. I want anyone, all the pundits, non-pundits, whatever, just go back and show me what I was incorrect about. Please. And it's not about, and there was, we couldn't have been about 52. You remember me saying the message they carried was above me? You don't remember me saying it over and over, Dawn?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so why would you hate someone? I was not the problem. People made 52 the problem, all right? I don't know.
I remember, too, we had an episode we brought on. That was last year, though.
Yeah, but
we,
then even the lady you brought on, she's incorrect because it does.
No, I was going to say that I remember you and her got into a debate, and after she said you were right.
Why? Listen to me, Dawn.
But I'm saying she agreed with you when you talked about your points.
She agreed with the molecular events, but she said that it couldn't alter your DNA. But then subsequently, we see Dr. Bean on personalized education trials. Like everybody's coming out saying that it's altered DNA and the spike protein is being found in sexual gonads, kidneys. It's even found in the target immune system. It's all type of thing. But what I really do is touch on any of it. Forget the science. Most people is this. FDX, right? I didn't comment because I'm not gullible. But what I'm saying is a lot of people coming on the radio about speculation. There's no speculation, you know, Dawn. Speculation, people are ignorant. There's no speculation. The fact remains, money is missing.
Yes.
Went from someone to someone. That's all I need to know. And then there were irregularities, right? Because you have international media putting out information, but yet still you have people talking about speculation. There's no speculation. There's a guy called Dwight yesterday. He's very brilliant. I always listen to him. And I think he does this online trading in Forex, because I have a cousin that does it. And what he said was something that I already known, but he's more
detailed
than me. So what he said was, and I knew this, the blockchain technology, you can actually see the transaction. But he explained about the key, private key and public key or whatever, but you could actually see all the transactions on the blockchain technology. So I don't know where all of this secrecy comes from as far as where this money went or what happened to it and all that. So do you remember now, Dawn, there's a psychology to lie in there. They just found out why do politicians lie. And there's a bunch of stuff.
But 52, if there was one event, we gotta cut for a second. If there was one event that you could say this year was the most memorable thing that you would recap, which event would that would be?
The lockdowns.
The end of the lockdowns, or?
You know, the end of the lockdown. I was mad with the lockdown because, Dawn, what I'm saying is the science was BS. You guys don't get it. When I said that you couldn't control viruses, influenza viruses, you know what is the heart of this? Antigenic shift and viral reassortment.
No, but I'm asking. So you think the end of the lockdowns was the most memorable event for you for the year?
Yeah, it was good. But the thing is, the most memorable event for me was being tyrannized by mass psychosis and majority of ignorant people bringing me down with them. Because 52 wanted to be liberated because he see that this I'm saying is humanity has let me down. This is the level I'm on.
I understand, 52. We're going to discuss some of this. Was it lockdown? Lockdowns was technically last year, wasn't it, when we ended them? I think that was the first thing the Davis administration did, was end the lockdown situation. Well, we ended the mask mandate this year. We didn't have lockdowns this year.
They ended emergency orders. They subsequently put in rules.
Emergency orders,
They subsequently put in rules. So I think when Minnis had already been out, lockdowns were already finished in a sense. Because after that, when he tried to shut down New Providence and everybody was it was going crazy. Did we see any more after that?
No.
So this point of them doing anything significant is not really true. That's a lie.
I unfortunately think the FTX thing, I think, dominated. Dominated much of the year, because the whole grand opening and the press conferences they had over
that was like a week, I think.
It was like relentlessly they were in the news from June, July of this year, straight up from international standpoint, straight up until the absolute meltdown occurred, and I that dominated much of the year, I think, in terms of what was like major events. I don't think you can speculate. Let me rephrase that. I don't think it's speculation to suggest that there's a very likely chance that there was fraudulent activity taking place. And this is not my opinion.
In terms of what? You mean as an FTX?
Yes.
Okay.
That relationship between them and Alameda Research, this is also not my opinion. I think the Securities Exchange Commission in the United States of America has also, I think, released a statement on that this week.
What did they say?
That there's very likely that fraudulent behavior took place.
Okay.
They're very careful with their words, because they're obviously, I presume, co-investigating this with Bahamian authorities. I remember, was it this week or was it last week?
They're the primary investigators. We're
no, we're not. I don't think we're the primary investigators.
No, I mean not us. I was not meaning us.
I would not want us to be the primary investigators.
Oh, no, don't trust us.
I remember I'd heard a statement made that the Security Commission, the SCB?
SCB.
Yeah, the Security Commission of Bahamas was working in conjunction with the Financial Crimes Unit and the Royal Bahamas Police Force. Now, again, I've met some folks from the Security Commission.
Okay.
I have some semblance. I have confidence in them. I don't have no confidence in the police to investigate this. I don't. I seriously hope that whatever charges that would be brought up will lead to just an extradition. I do not have the confidence that our judicial system, whatever the judicial system does, I think will look bad. In that, if this case is expedited and all of a sudden they could knock out a case in a couple of weeks, which takes people whose family members have been murdered years to actually complete, if they are able to fast-track this case to getting a fast date, if the charges are ever brought up, when people get charged and then 2 years later or a year later, they're actually going to court to face charges. It
makes you wonder if the backlog is actually a backlog.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. And then the next problem is, if it is in fact going to be a backlog situation, it's going to be an absolute embarrassment to see how absolutely kapunkalup the backlog within the court system is to get this matter solved. Because again, this isn't simply pertaining to the Bahamas government and Bahamians. This is international, not just Americans either. The people all over the world, that they're not going to be made whole. Most people will not be made whole in this situation. They'll get pennies on the dollar. Mm-hmm. But these pennies on the dollar are going all over the world. This is probably the biggest meltdown we've had in the country with the liquidation process. And considering the absolute fart show that this whole sovereignty thing has created with the United States authorities and the ensuing public relations fallout and turmoil that we're facing, I dare say this has scarred the Bahamas again.
Mm-hmm.
We have plenty of scars. We like to act like we is the previous.
Every administration has a scar.
True. This is like the PLP's over. Is it really?
Is it? Well, because they're going to use the excuse and say, well, you know, FTX was here. They technically incorporated or registered within the Bahamas under the FNM. But see, this is the thing, right? I'm not disagreeing with that. It's true. But the thing is like the... It's just like the Peter Nygaard situation, minus the crimes that Peter Nygaard is accused of. The proximity of leaders to these sorts of people matters. Because when you have photographs of high-ranking government officials or the prime minister of the country, like...
Like a senior policy advisor.
Yeah, like photograph
or the former attorney general
who are being accused. Right? Well, not just the word accused, charged. Now, SPF isn't in that case, but the previous fella I just mentioned, Nygaard, charged with a crime, especially the types of crimes. And the story is that political cover was given within the country. And then the story is coming out about the situation under FTX. I don't think any behavior, it's almost to the point you could make up anything at this point and say that it happened in the Bahamas, and I'm more than likely to believe it. Because I know this country, and I live here, and I'm a Bahamian. I don't believe any single thing they write. But I know if a young lady can go to a police station and allegedly get driven back by the police, allegedly, to Peter Nygaard's residence to continue the abuse that was happening, I don't have no confidence in this country at all. We don't have any integrity, clearly. And the responses that I remember at the time by the police force were just, like, we have no record of this happening. It's like, of course you didn't, because you didn't take any statements. Or any complaints. So what do you expect to hear? Yeah. Also, I guess we could recap. That's going to be a scar, I think, for the rest
for a while, For the next 4 years?
Yes. Then Billy McFarlane. This year has been a clown year for
Was that true? Like, was that real that he...
Yes, he was on Twitter talking about it.
Wow. But Twitter isn't a real place.
No, but he legit... had been in the news in the United States saying he wanted to make amends for what happened in the Bahamas.
Don't talk to us.
Isn't it interesting that all these things are happening the instant our economy is recovering? Like this year has been the year of supposed turnaround, where we're getting back closer to 2019 levels, which isn't that great either, because remember, Dorian happened in 2019. This has not been a good year for the Bahamas. It started off shaky. In the middle of it, it seemed like things were looking up. Hotel numbers were skyrocketing.
And now it's like, oh, boom.
Economy is doing better, but it's like our international reputation. Jesus Christ. It's
short. No amount of trips and travel.
And international. What is he? The climate voice of climate change internationally?
But he apparently has a model that people like.
Yeah, that Egypt wants to copy as well.
Yeah.
He took that trip.
And you know, if the Egyptians want to copy us, I don't know if that's a good thing. Especially given their president.
Who's their president again?
He's a dictator.
Well, aren't they always?
Oh, they're all dictators, right?
Since Nasser, I don't think they ever had a democratically...
I don't think so, no.
...maintained leader after Abdel al-Nasser. But
I think Biden, didn't he say on the campaign trail talking about that how he's going to stop supporting Egypt, I think it was?
They all say funny things. But you know, the whole thing with Saudi Arabia has kind of changed priorities. And if you recall correctly... Remember earlier the year we also had, I'm going to say this, I think we should bring the Ukrainian ambassador to the Bahamas on the show.
That's going to be interesting.
It'd be a very fascinating conversation, because I remember vividly, I don't know if you recall, Stefano, when the war broke out between Russia and Ukraine, the U.S. embassy started releasing statements about the Bahamas joining the sanctions regime against Russia, and Russia, who had essentially not really spoken to the Bahamas or addressed this country, specifically from Cuba, I believe, started sending messages to this country saying, essentially, we're looking forward to doing business with the Bahamas. And I was like, bro, whatever is going on, I'm not the government, but me as a Bahamian, I want nothing to do with whatever y'all doing.
Listen, keep me out of it.
Yeah. We have no army. Our economy is tiny. We can't do nothing, bro. Just, I want no problems.
Yeah.
But we became...
Like, just leave us alone. You know, it's almost like we're coming to a point whereas we need another non-aligned movement, right? It's like, we don't have to align with these multipolar powers. And I think it's coming to that stage again where it's like a Cold War level. It's coming to that stage again.
We're already there,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah.
And then Ukraine made statements about the Bahamas as well, in reference to countries like ours.
Supporting them
and sanctioning Russia, not allowing them to find places to place their money and sell their oil. Which then subsequently part of the reason why oil prices
skyrocketed here
the way that they did. This year has been an absolute, it's been a roller coaster for this country, I have to say.
In the next 4 years, when election comes around, then, do you think we'll remember all of this?
I'm going to remember
not
all
us,
of it.
Not us, but I mean.
Well, I'm going to
I still remember Ramway Wells never really addressed a letter of intention, though. Yeah. With that, anyway.
But
did Brave address Bamsey burning down?
Not
did
really.
They ever properly address that?
No, they didn't properly address
right?
it. He made a statement statements about it, but it wasn't like a... There was no investigation into any of those
And
things.
Then there's a Nolly prosecute too, you know? Into his home, and him being, you know...
Yes! That happened in the... Yeah, I don't. We don't forget the... Well, let me not say
but
that.
But you know what this always comes back to?
The public doesn't care, it seems.
This no. always comes back to information and how we don't have very much of it in the Bahamas. And I think that if we had a lot more information, I think we'd be a way better society than we are now.
You ever thought about how scary it would be? If for much criticism as people levy against the media and people like us, if we didn't exist, you would know absolutely nothing in this country. Like
I would hope the sweetheart of one of them would say something.
go on a WhatsApp.
Yeah, go on a WhatsApp.
Censorship would be twice. It'd be skewed, even more skewed. And it would. The best thing that ever happened in this country was leaks. We haven't been getting much of those recently.
Like I think but I saw I was in the Facebook and
the
in
PR is on point.
It was,
yeah.
Well, they're gonna fix this. How much you want back?
I didn't think though. I think Ryan Penn.
It may take a while. Address.
Oh my god!
Ryan Penn's national address did not help.
I told everybody to watch it.
That did not help.
That was last week.
Yeah, it was last week.
Yes, I told everybody to watch it. That
garbage.
It was.
Because
everything was wrong.
And it was like what he was trying to address is like nobody was asking.
He was answering questions. No one asked whether the Bahamas had any credibility. No one asked if this place over for business. No one asked if your authorities are. I'm sure Bahamians have those concerns, but you have to have thought. I'm sure they have thought when they formulated that speech that this is a speech that will be picked up by the international press far more than it's picked up from local authorities. Mm-hmm. And that doesn't mean you shouldn't address the local concerns of Bahamas. Absolutely you should, but you should also think about crafting your messaging because it was picked up. And he was destroyed in the international press as they... I can say that. They, the international press, whether it be those who cover cryptocurrency or the mainstream corporate American media... Some were very neutral on the issue. Others were extraordinarily biased in saying that, suggesting that he's in on something, that he's trying too hard to talk about the country's credibility when no one asks, which brings up causes of concern.
Didn't he work at Deltek Bank?
Yes, he did, which is also...
And didn't we see a report in the Tribune today talking about them being hushed on like a
certain week a report came out that...
Well, y'all let them U.S. FTX. Investigators come down here. They got up all...
Well, there's a documentary in the works now. Two documentaries in the works. I find it interesting, too, that everybody who is in the... not even international press. Lots of Twitter people and YouTubers are doing interviews with SBF, but not one single Bahamian... journalist has been able to secure one of those things. It literally is the case, which demonstrates what we spoke about when FTX first started blowing up with the press releases and press conferences and with the prime minister. As we said right here on the show, that most of the things that you're going to see happening has nothing to do with Bahamians.
Right.
And considering that this man lives in Nassau, has not spoken, to my understanding, once to the Bahamian press.
And most of the stories that we see of him in the press are them doing stories on other stories.
Yes,
basically,
it's almost like he doesn't live here. Yeah. It's almost like being in Albany and Lifeakea and all these other places when things like this happen, which isn't very often. It's literally as if those places were not a part of the Bahamas. Mm-hmm.
They aren't. If we're like the U.S., so that's Florida. What's
no, over there is the U.S.
No, I mean over here. Yeah,
yeah,
over
there. Over here.
So just like how they have the states, that's his own separate. That's his own separate state. So New Providence is split up. We have this side over here, and then we have that separate state right over there.
Like I said last week, the people in the city are basically in District 9. Everybody on the core, on the periphery of the island is like a different District 9. They're probably like District 1 or something. Like, we don't matter. Like, our stories don't matter, but those people out there, they matter more than us, in a sense.
They don't need us.
Yeah.
They don't. Everything is there for them. They don't need. They don't.
So it's
need,
like we live in two countries, two economies. Like
no, there, no, yeah. There, that is true. There's research.
Yeah.
From Olivia Saunders from the University of Palmas that supports that. You talk about this dual economy that we have. 90% of the economy, almost 90%, is foreign.
Out of our hands.
Yeah, and out of that 90%, 85% of that money leaves the country. So,
this is the Nazi model, man. This is the advertising model. You know what that is? Garbage. Yeah.
I think we should have a conversation about ideology in January.
Mm-hmm.
Really dissecting what this country really is. Because I saw a lot of the commentary all year about this whole freedom of speech thing and this, oh, Jesus. I actually want to posit something here before we go to turn to a positive note before we have to end. The Bahamas doesn't fully embrace all of the tenets of bad governance, right? We have some good components to it, some good social mobility, different sorts of policies that kind of contradicts some of the things the government does that kind of works out for the better of the people. But when you really dig down to the core of it, Tate, we do fit majority of the tenets of a fascist, not fascist regime, but just the government and how it functions. Because there isn't a real freedom of speech in the Bahamas. Like, if I say that a judge is a bad word, which I'm not saying, just putting on a record, I can get charged with criminal libel. If I make a song about the prime minister like someone did in the past, they technically can charge you with sedition.
Didn't he go to jail for that?
No, he apologized. He apologized to the prime minister. He visited his house. Christie visited his house and everything. It was a whole thing with him and his wife. I'm serious, because they could have charged the young man with sedition.
Can we still find that song? I hope I can still find that song.
Huh, Perry Christie song?
Yeah.
Yes, you probably still can find it, actually.
Somewhere deep in the WhatsApp archives.
You can probably
I'm going to see that.
Someone has it.
There's also the issue of, I said criminal libel already, right? Yes, sedition, criminal libel. And on a positive note, I'm just saying that these are things I think we have to discuss more of and ways that we change that. But I kind of feel like these conversations about the solutions sometimes feel like they're pointless because these things have been written about for almost 30 years. Amnesty International has been talking about the Bahamas' need to move away from them for like literally 30 years. If I recall correctly, I think the IDB also commissioned a paper that also spoke about these issues. There are tons of literature and research that speaks to what the issues are that these things create. And the ultimate consequence is that people will become afraid to talk, because there is fear that the system will be used against them. Unfortunately, the system is incredibly decrepit, broken down, and dysfunctional. But when that dysfunctional system turns around and points at you, literally there's nothing you can do. It's over for you, basically, for a season. But you found it.
I found the song.
We can't play that song.
You can't play that song. Last night.
But yes, but I'm saying this is a part of it.
But I'll play it on my way to work.
I'm not going there with you, Tate. I'm not going there with you. But I'll say next week, I think I have a guest in mind now. We need to go through specifically January to June of this year of like the malarkey that happened. I don't know if you'll recall, there were tons of press conferences at OPM making promises about doing things, including lots of legislation that has seemingly gone nowhere. We're going to see next year what has happened. Because remember this year we talked about Tate, about citizenship laws, changing laws on marijuana. Remember
I think even so, we were supposed to have a marijuana law this year. And we haven't seen that as yet.
We were supposed to change the law we did change one law, I think in January, which was that if you strike somebody with a car, vehicle manslaughter, that you do no longer just pay $10,000. You can now be liable for, I think it's up to 5 years in prison.
Whenever I get to finish my master's, right, one thing that I want to do is look at like policy and like the history of it, right, and looking at the number of laws that were enacted and seeing how much of them really affected the Bahamians. And I think it would be a very low number of laws that did that.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm going to look you right in the eyes to say yes. That's precisely what it is.
Yeah.
But it's Christmas coming up, right? You got to be so positive. I don't know if are y'all staying in Nassau for Christmas?
Yes.
I will probably be in Canada once again this year.
I may be in Atlanta. Yeah. I need to see that kind
of. I had a choice between California and Canada, and Canada's full
time. I'll be right here.
I don't know if I'm going to.
Enjoying Junkanoo.
I can't say. I need to find out from a friend If he's coming to Nassau or if I'm going to Atlanta or how we're going to plan it. Oh, you got John Canoe. You know, I broke a promise to myself this year. I said in January that I would rush in John Canoe this year. And I realized sometime in June that probably ain't happened because it's like when you work four jobs, you really ain't got no time for nothing.
Yeah.
So I broke that promise to myself. And I have no one to blame for that but myself.
December 1st.
World AIDS Day. December. Also my birthday. Yes, mm-hmm. I've turned the great age of 30. I'm no longer 29. I'm an old man now. I have to pass the torch.
I'll be 23 in like about 28 days, something like that.
They leave in the country, man. These fellas ain't.
Oh my God.
Hold on.
I will still be here. I'll still be here. I think I will still be here. I mean, as in like, not physically, but like intellectually.
That's something that we discussed. You know, the Eye Opener is a show that's always been about. Like, I'm not the first host of the show, Savannah, because mm-hmm. I know you weren't here from the beginning. I wasn't here at the beginning either. This is actually, I think, if not the oldest, the second oldest show.
Yes, it's the second
on
oldest
Guardian.
Yeah.
Mm. Probably, what's the oldest one? Morning Blend?
Morning Blend, of course. You know, the
yes,
Overlord.
Yes, yes. The Overlord Dwight. I'm sure he's listening. But no, it's the oldest show on second oldest show on Guardian. And the tradition of the show is that when you pass a show along, usually to University of the Bahamas students, because all of us came from the university. That's how the show was birthed. And I've been trying for 2.5-3 years now to find suitable people to pass the torch on to. That's not as easy as it sounds. Mm-hmm. And I know I'm not throwing shit at anybody. I'm just saying.
But I do think that persons who actually want to do this, because I've been doing this for like 5 years
now. It is
now.
A challenge.
Driving here, I had to walk here sometimes. I had to like...
But you live around
take a bus. I used to live in Arcona. Yeah, that's true. That's true. That's true.
He's making it sound like he's walking backwards in the snow up the hill from Fox Hill.
But I do look forward like every Saturday to come here and talk like garbage. Not talk garbage, but like
chocolate
with you guys.
Mm-hmm. We do. It's factual stuff. It's factual stuff. But it's like we get to be...
It's funny and sarcastic. Because
you can't talk about... You can't critique issues, which people need to stop confusing complaining with critiquing. You can't critique issues serious all the time. It's not very digestible. No. That's why we inject lots of humor and sarcasm into it, but also a brutal sense of reality, which is something we've always done on the show. What I used to call it now, gin and Cersei.
Mm-hmm.
You've had Cersei before?
Yeah,
them two things shouldn't
Who
go together.
Hasn't?
You'd be surprised. You know what? You actually know what
in
I
the Bahamas?
Want? Oh, yes.
What?
You know what I want? We need to make it a thing. We need to find someone who makes it and probably do a giveaway for Christmas. We're going to do some giveaways. I'm gonna make an active effort.
I know a lady.
Sorrel.
I know a lady.
Sorrel. I want to give away a gallon of Sorrel or 2 gallons of Sorrel to listeners this year. I know a lot of Bahamians haven't had Sorrel before, and I would like you to have the gift of the greatest drink ever gifted to humankind by probably West Africans and Caribbean people.
You can put it in your stocking.
You've had Sorrel before?
Yes.
Oh, you cultured? Did you have had Sorrel before?
What is that? Is that like a wine
you
or something?
Uncultured
He's
swine.
From Grand Bahama.
Is that like
that.
A wine or something?
No. Sorrel, I mean, you can... No, you can make a wine out of it, I think. I'm pretty sure you can. There's a whole process of doing that I don't fully understand. But no, it's a drink. It's a red drink made from a flour that you usually steep / boil.
It's from Guyana?
They make it all over the Caribbean. Okay. The Bahamas is one of the places that we seem to have lost that...
Our roots?
Yes, way long time ago, we used to make Sorrel. No, it wasn't as big as it is in Jamaica, Cayman, Barbados, Trinidad.
Lost our
roots.
Kind of. Essentially.
In West Africa, they have another name for it. Not Sipsit.
I'm sure there's names everywhere.
Yeah,
there's different names
everywhere. It's like Asus. Some people call it Susu. Some call it. I can't remember, they can't say the next name.
Isn't it like Swore or something like that?
Something like that. It's from West Africa.
Yeah. If you see the photo of Gnep going around, it'd be like, oh, what do you call it where you're from?
Is it Gnep or Gnep? See, that's another question.
I don't know. I just
it's actually
pronounce
called
it
Spanish lime.
See, look.
Ain't nobody using that name.
That's true. That's Gnep. True. That's true. Yeah, it's Gnep.
Well, you should Gnep, but you ain't because... Oh,
right,
I
don't even know the real pronunciation. It's something.
I don't know the name. Like tamarind. Like, is it tamarind or tamarind? Because we used to
say tamarind.
Tamarind. There's a D in there, isn't
tamarind and Gnep.
There's a D in. You have a tamarind sauce?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I have some of my friends right now.
Why you gotta give me some of that? I want some of that. Where you get it from?
A lady on Bugatti Road.
You are the most Bahamian young man I've ever met in my entire life. Because plenty young, but like, Tay don't even know what juju and hot sauce is.
What?
See, look at him. He's so confused. Mm. You never know what salty is? Y'all too busy playing.
I'm not a real Bahamian. I'm from Grand Bahama.
Y'all too busy playing Pocky
in
Grand Bahama.
Grand Bahama, right? And then it,
No. I'm Sean Wesson, and I'll play Porky.
But there's a conversation to be had, right? Because we were talking about junk food this week sometime, right? And I'm like, when I was living in Freeport, I didn't give a hoot about what Junkanoo was. Like, nobody cared about that. Mm-hmm. But seeing it as, like, a big culture over here, I'm like, that really shows how much we're different between different islands. And so it's like, over here, it's like a team sport. Exactly.
I was going to ask, do you think it's just you? Because one of my classmates, she's from Freeport, and she going back to do Junkanoo in Freeport.
Well, I've spoken to other persons who from Grand Bahama who said as well that they don't care about it. Yeah. So it's like, it's different.
I mean, it was mentioned that why don't you stay here for real Junkanoo instead of going
exactly.
back? I mean, it was said
exactly. So it's like, you know, what is Bahamian? Is Junkanoo just a Nassau thing that was exported to the islands?
They do it in Luther as well.
I've heard people say that it was exported there. So I don't know if it's actually inherently to that particular island.
Junkanoo was developed and mutated into a bunch of different things.
Yeah. Maybe you have a Junkanoo Carnival, you know?
What is that? It's
supposed to be $1 billion a year, you know, for the Bahamas.
I got part of the issue with Junkanoo Carnival. Yeah. But the morality issue was, it was always, I just didn't want tax dollars going into that because we're not going to get a return, mm-hmm. which we never did. We never actually got that report either. See, I don't forget things.
Exactly.
Then my homeboy, he borrowed from Peter to pay Paul. Anyway, like four people will get that joke. But that's fine. That's a very deep joke about the nature of corruption in this country. But that's a whole other conversation. We're out of time. Any final words, guys?
I think I'm going to end with how I always end, but keep paying attention. I think it's a bit painful at sometimes, or you want to just stop paying attention at sometimes. But I think it's worthwhile to see, like, when you understand what's going on, it feels good. And it also is depressing at the same time. But it feels good to understand what's going on in this country. And I think that we should always pay attention. And I think once you pay attention and once we get more information, I think we begin to see the Bahamas we want to see. Yeah.
I think, seeing as this was a recap of, a brief recap of the year in general, I just want to remind the listeners, like, not to forget. Let's make a note of things that are happening that we never got answers to, that we still need answers to. And we got to keep asking those, we got to keep looking for answers to those questions that we have. Because if we just forget about it and let it slide away, why, you know, what are we doing, essentially?
Who are we, Duval? Let me stop. I think that Defense Force Marine also, that event happened. Yes. But I want to do a shout out before we go as my final word, obviously. Again, Tada has been, and Tanil Tada Burrows, right? Has been a friend of the show for a very long time, very supportive. I think from my beginning of coming on this show, I invited Tanil on several times. So anyway, I just want to give a shout out to Tada. Please do not forget, she's having a concert December 10th at the Atlantis Theater. You can grab a ticket on Eventbrite. Just search up Tada, T-A-D-A. General admission tickets are $45. Again, on the eye opener, we long since support Bahamian artists, those who are friends of the show. Some of the artists that we used to feature no longer live in this country because they've gone on to bigger and better things. And we would love to be a part of the process of highlighting and uplifting our local artists. So again, that's December 10th. You can get a ticket on the Eventbrite. That's Tada. She's having a concert at the Atlantis Theater. December 10th. Lock it in. This has been The Eye Opener, your weekly dose of something absolutely different. And we'll leave you guys on an absolutely positive, positive, positive note. Yes, you should not forget. But also, too, do something for Christmas, man. You ain't got to buy nothing expensive. Make some sorrel. Go up on YouTube and find a recipe for sorrel. I am going to try to get a giveaway this Christmas so you guys can have something. We're going to play ourselves out to a song of Tada. But we got to say the closing words. When many hands build a school, many hands storm something, build a home. But it takes many engaged Bahamians like me and you
to build a better Bahamas.
Be good, Bahamas.
Look at the footprints in the sand. You think you walk alone, but he's holding your hand. Never let go and you still stand. You still stand. You still stand. Look at the
the signs and wonder he pray. The sun always rises in the early morning. Times might be rough, but I shall sing. I shall sing, I shall sing. Where there's hope, there will always be a tiny little window of opportunity. Where there is faith, things come to pass. Eternal life is the only thing that lasts. Look at the footprints in the sand. You think you walk alone, but he's holding your hand. Never let go and you still stand. You still stand, you still stand. Look at the signs and wonder he bring. The sun always rises in the early morning. Times might be rough, but I shall sing. I shall sing, and you I shall sing.
Jesus came to set us free.
Alone, but he's holding your hand. Never let go, and you still stand. You still stand, you still stand. Look at the signs and wonder he brings. The sun always rises in the early morning. Times might be rough, but I shall sing. I shall sing, I shall sing
to the sunrise.